Thank you very much, Jiri. Thank you very much for hosting me and inviting me to speak today. As Jiri said, my name is Jacob Green. I am an American who's been spending a moment.
Yeah, you are muted. No, I'm
here. Good. Perfect. Who's been spending a lot of time trying to institutionalize open source. And what I mean by that is creating the offices of open source around the world. And we can kind of think of this as a new distributed institution of this movement, which we're all talking about and participating in, which is open source. I'm the founder of the Institutes of Applied Open Source, the OSPO++ Network, and Moss Labs, which is very much policy-driven in conjunction with similarly with open cities. This is a network. We are part of a global community where we're trying to build OSPOs in Carnegie Mellon University, Johns Hopkins University. We work with Open Forum Europe. Congratulations for the Czech National OSPO. I'm extremely excited to see this launching here. The Open Ireland Network, the Baltimore-Washington Open Source Network, the City of Paris has launched an OSPO. We work with the small St. Francis Neighborhood Center in the city of Baltimore. It is the oldest community center, and so when we say we work with Baltimore, we work with the constituents of Baltimore in an underserved neighborhood. And we work with the Inner Source Commons. This is just a small sampling of the partners we're working with. What do I mean when I say open source? Let's go for a broad definition. Both the legal and the code, I like to call that the bottom of the stack, that's the noun. That's the stuff. That's the code you're producing, the licenses that you're choosing, and that nature. But there's a verb to this as well. And that verb is the collaboration on code, that is the idea of cooperative economics, the idea of getting work done as a group. And that's the output of a lot of open source projects. But how you do that is an art. That is the language of community. That's the verb. I also want to stress the idea of open source as a movement. There's an aspect of open source which is not just about the code or the collaboration, but I will give it the example. I can walk into a coffee shop, and if I have an open source t-shirt on, I'm more likely to have someone say, yeah, right on, you know, sort of thing. It's associated with openness, with transparency, with democracy. It's being asked to do all these things, at least in the public psyche. And for that reason, I like to think of open source also as an aspect of having a movement. When you take all of these three things put together, and we're looking at open source, I'm looking at it not just from the legal and technical aspects of it, but how we can then use open source and how it affects and the implications at the social, the political, and the economic layers above. As we institutionalize open source, I dare everyone to have a large ambition level. We have one shot at institutionalizing open source across the board, and we're at a unique green field situation. I'd rather aim for floor 100 and only reach floor 75 than only just start walking up and getting tired and ending at floor 10. It's important to set an ambitious goal. I think open source is this global movement, this global aspect that as we can institutionalize globally, that is the opportunity that awaits us. But this is a community experiment, and we should go into it thinking of it if it's a living, breathing experiment made up of a community experiment. That means it's an experiment that we're all participating in, and we need your help. So what does it mean when we say Dare to Dream OSPOs? Yesterday, we had a great session in the afternoon where we tried to, we did a workshop looking to see what could the Czech National OSPO do? What should it be working on? What are the policy initiatives that they should be looking at? Also within an eye from the global community and the other stakeholders that were there to help ideate what that would mean. But I don't want just their opinions. We're looking for everyone's opinions. So I ask you in the room, and we'll talk to this later on near the end of the presentation when Dorka and Jiri come up. What are your dreams for open source? And how can an open source program office potentially help achieve those things? But as we're asking about open source, there's a cultural aspect to this, and an idea that if we want to make, it's the idea of enlightened self-interest, that if we want the dreams of your dreams for what open source is, we also have to look at what other people's dreams are for open source. And so as you're thinking of what can we throw into the Czech National OSPO, I also want you to think about what can the Czech National OSPO do globally to help other OSPOs in the idea that they would undergo that same thought experiment to say, how can their OSPO both help them and help the Czech National OSPO. Before we go too much further, what is an OSPO? I'll be talking about that in a second. We'll be going through a landscape of where we have OSPOs so far, both in industry, government, and academia, about the processes of building these and building what we see this as global digital infrastructure, some of the current uses of OSPOs, and some collaborative examples. What's an OSPO? I wish there was just a definition that I could just put out there, say, do this, this is an OSPO, but that's not how it works. An OSPO is what I like to call it, an organizational construct, or the office of open source. It has been popularized, and we have many examples of OSPOs in industry. Google, Microsoft, Red Hat have OSPOs. But also you'll find them at Comcast, American Airlines, and European companies, Orange, and a number of others. We're now also looking at them for industries, and outside of industry, we're looking to say, where can we apply OSPOs? Where can open source is used extensively in academia, in governments, all the way from cities to nations to regions to, for example, the UN and the European Commission. None of these OSPOs are the same. So we're ending up with a heterogeneous mix of these offices of open source. At the end of the day, these are offices that also try to achieve policy outcomes. Because we're asking, if you build an OSPO for an organization or for a region, the question is going to be asked, why are we doing this? What is the policy concern? What is the policy objective we're trying to achieve with open source? We have to go back to first principles for that, of what that means for academia. How can an open source support academia? And I'd like to think of this in the four pillars of academia. How can it support education? Open source is an amazing experiential learning opportunity. How can it support research? Open source is critical to open science and the reproducibility of science. In order for you get reproducibility, you have the paper that gets written, the data that's used to write the paper, and the software that's used to generate the data to write the paper. Unless you have all three and they're made open, you don't have the ability to reproduce that, and you don't have open science. The next one is the idea of research translation. Thinking of the idea of using the open source ecosystem itself to take that innovation of that research and translate it or transfer it to others so that it can be used in society. Typically, we think of research translation only through the lens of entrepreneurship or the selling of intellectual property through copyrights and patents. The open source project ecosystem brings together many players together to allow the innovation that gets created there to be translated. And finally, The fourth pillar of academia that will bring is that the universities do not exist alone. They typically exist within a city or a region that they are a member of, and they often have responsibilities and obligations to give back and to engage in the city and region they're in. Then we're looking at it from a government's point of view. What would an OSPO be for government? And this is a very interesting question that we're just starting to scratch the surface with. I was very happy to see the European Commission launching the beginnings of an OSPO network for nation state OSPOs, where we're gonna be beginning to figure out together what this means. One thing that we've come to a little bit of consensus on, at least with some of the members, is the idea of the what we call the OSPO base, OSPO plus plus base state OSPO, where the idea that an OSPO has two parts, most of them. The idea of doing open source, the capacity, how to educate your developers, how to support them, which licenses to choose, how to do open source. But the other aspect of this is about cooperation, whether that's as an organizational construct, whether that's building up cooperation between organizational units within within your organization, whether that's looking at it from cooperation with external parties, or whether that's looking at it from cooperation within the system that an organization might exist. The university here exists within a system of other universities and within a global system of higher education. How can a university OSPO help to affect and achieve the policy goals of the system of as well as the individual? One of the things that we don't want to happen is siloed OSPOs. As we build these things, we don't want them to be built in isolation. That's antithetical to the cultural norms of open source itself. So the challenge is here is to not have siloed OSPOs and get them to cooperate together. This is a greenfield opportunity. If you then think of the OSPOs as these new constructs globally in industry, academia, and government, where we can work together on shared policy goals. And not just to think of this as a utopia of pat ourselves on the back, we're going to do just this for good. This is an opportunity for cooperative economics. This is to say, how can we balance the interests of what everyone in this ecosystem is looking to achieve so that we can all achieve positive outcome together? I think we just went over most of that, sorry about that. Let's get to some specific examples. What do I mean when I say policy things that we can work on together? This decade is going to be the Europe's digital decade. How can open source help to achieve that outcome? How can open source program offices help to achieve that outcome? How can a distributed system of open source program offices help to achieve that outcome? If we look at another very specific policy outcome, the idea of securing the software supply chain and securing this open code and collaboration that exists. This is another example where we have broad opportunity for global cooperation because we all benefit from secure software. How can we work on this policy goal together? How can open source help this? How can the members of the open source community help this? And how can OSPOs in general help this? There are a number, as we outlined yesterday in the working session, there are a number of other policy objectives if you look at it from a nation state perspective of what are some of the policy outcomes you're trying to achieve that many people are already asking now, how can open source help to achieve that? Workforce development, social impact, democracy and participatory budgeting. I'll give you the example of the city of Paris. That they run the largest participatory budgeting system where they take 5% of their entire city budget and they democratize. That's all powered by an open source platform called Lutes. And they're very proud of that. In the public health sector, for digital independence and digital sovereignty, from open cities, which is a shared policy thing from the city of Baltimore that I'm very passionate about. As I said, cybersecurity, et cetera. I'll give you a little bit of, again, more concrete examples of a little bit of the OSPO landscape so far. We now have OSPOs at the United Nations. The WHO launched an OSPO. There was a large meeting about it where it was presented at the General Assembly on Thursday, the same day we were having the European Commission launching of their OSPO network. The European Commission has an OSPO. The city of Paris has an OSPO. As I said before, that city of Paris OSPO, it was looking to achieve a policy outcome. It put 50 million euros into developing a platform to power all digital services in the city of Paris. Yet it had no developer community, and it had no user community. And so their challenge is that they're trying to use their OSPO for is to build global collaboration around their platform, both for the platform itself, but also for the uses such as digital democracy and the spreading of that as well. That's the use of, that's some of the primary goals that the Paris OSPO is looking to achieve. If I look to Germany and what it's trying to achieve with a number of, it's got a little bit of a federated OSPO system as well. One of the things that I'm looking at there is there's a group that's focused on public administrations. Why? One of the things that they're doing there is public administrations, they're looking to increase innovation, and they're looking to solve a challenge, which is one-third of their entire public administration workforce from the federal, state, and local is going to be aging out within 8 years. That's a gigantic institutional change and opportunity to bring in a new educated workforce that knows how to work, speak, open source, and get fast innovation into the public administration space. This we look at this as infrastructure and the idea to collaborate. But we have to be a little bit careful here of the idea of not just collaborating for the sake of collaborating, it's the idea of collaborating to get work done that we are all finding benefit from. And that's, I think, the distinguishing thing that distinguishes an open source project is work actually gets done. I have talked to the CIO of Paris on a number of times, and I think I'll paraphrase what she has said to me, is that we don't want to be involved in just another network that doesn't get things done. It's great to collaborate and it's great to talk to one another, but they'd really like to be involved in networks of collaboration that get work done. So there's a number of efforts to get work done in a distributed fashion. As I mentioned before, the European OSPO network was just had its first meeting here in Brno, very excited to say, last Thursday. The launch of the Czech National OSPO, congratulations. I'm thrilled to work with you all to see where this can go and as a model for others to look at, to look at the idea of open cities. We at OSPO++ are looking to build this global network of OSPOs, this global distributed system of collaboration. We run the US policy roundtable, in addition, where we're looking at what would a US national OSPO look like? What would a US national network in the US look like? Because the various different government agencies may not want to play well together, and they're gonna want their own OSPOs versus one centralized thing. Which again, I'm very looking forward to the experiment of the Czech Republic in terms of building a federated set of partners for that way. That other example here is the Mid-Atlantic in the US OSPO. We're exploring has a lot of patterns that I see the Czech National OSPO. So I'm very excited to learn from you as well as share our learnings with you. Giving you a little bit of a hint in what some of the current uses of OSPO are thinking could be. But I think the long-term potential is the future uses. And what, you know, if we look 5 years from now, and we have a number of OSPOs, and we have a number of these institutional constructs, and we're getting the how to cooperate together down, what could we do with that? What would you want to do with that? That's for me the driving thing that I'm really excited about. I'll give you, again, a concrete example of a cooperation between OSPOs. The city of Paris, as I said before, built an OSPO. They have their platform, Lutèce, which powers all digital services. We took that platform and we cooperated with them for more than a year with the Johns Hopkins University OSPO. Johns Hopkins University, for those that don't know, is the largest research university in the United States. It is about 45 minutes away from Washington, D.C. And from that OSPO, we set as its first priority to engage with the local community in Baltimore, which is, those that you don't know, Baltimore is having a lot of challenges right now. And so my first focus was really focusing on the constituents there. So we took the City of Paris platform. We engaged with the university through their OSPO to the Baltimore community. This is the first example of a concrete OSPO to OSPO collaboration between universities and cities transatlantic. We'd like to get a lot more of these, as we spoke yesterday, of these transatlantic cooperations. A number of these folks here, we had a nice session. The City of Paris hosted us at City Hall last November. It was a bit of a hybrid session, but some came locally, and where we bring together a number of the players, Open Forum Europe, the United Nations was there, as well as the Community Center from Baltimore flew over to attend this session. As I said from the very beginning, this is an experiment. We need your help. So with that, we're going to give it a little bit more of a interactive feel. I welcome you to participate. Dorka, Jiri, maybe you can come up and we can give a little bit more interactivity to this.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Should I just hold it like this? Hello, everyone. What's the... Yeah. Great group here.
Dorka, so, who are you?
That's a good question. We can start there. So my name is Dorka Volavkova. I see some familiar faces, but I'll add more information. I work at Red Hat as a community architect in OSPO, so Open Source Program Office. And unlike some of my colleagues who are focused on a certain project, building, finding contributors and building relationships with them around a certain project, I am focusing on what's happening here in Brno, because we have a huge Red Hat office in Brno. So it's sort of related to what we're trying to do with Czech National OSPO, because as Jacob said, OSPO++, it is a global network. But Czech National OSPO requires a lot of regional, local work. And that's close to what I do. I try to build a community. I try to build a platform that we can lead conversations, technology conversations. Right now, it's very focused on what Red Hat does, because I work there. But I feel like it's important to build a platform that we can lead a technology conversation related to what's happening in public sector to help us create or build further the Czech National OSPO. Because, yeah, the issues that we're experiencing are very regional, so if you look at an example of, I don't know, like digital identity, it's very, very local. How our, I say our, even though I'm from Slovakia, how Czech government entities interact with each other, how Czech citizens how do they use their digital identity? So we need to figure that out here regionally. Yeah, which is...
You want to talk about the regionality a little bit?
Yeah.
Okay, so hello everyone. I'm back on stage, Jiří Marek from Open Cities. And so thank you very much for driving this session, and it was really a great job. And I would like to also thank you both, you know, that you were participating that. And basically, all the running of the yesterday conference, Dorka was the key player there, you know, so we are really happy that this this all happened. So from the regional perspective and OSPOs, basically, we recognize when we start to look internationally, you know, because open cities are kind of like Czech project, you know, and in Czech Republic we like it to do it our way, you know, so but we should also share common knowledge or share best practices. So basically when we looked abroad, we said, hey, there is something called OSPO, you know, this is maybe interesting label and what they are doing there. And we recognize basically that open cities as an NGO are kind of local OSPO, you know, that we already are OSPO. But we know that in the Czech Republic we are not able to do it by ourselves because we need more visibility, and we have, I would say that you in the audience, you know about digitalization of Czech Republic, like in general for the public administration. So basically, this is one problem. And then you add the second problem for the public officers, use open source, you know. And they usually are stuck with the first step, you know, how to digitalize in the first step. And then you are saying, yeah, and if you are digitalizing, making digitalization, yes, add that the level of complexity of open source, you know. So basically, to enable to come this dream, you know, of open cities to be using open source in public administration in the Czech Republic. So we said, hey, let's kickstart the national OSPO as a federation, as Jacob said, because we don't want to build another agency, but we would like to connect the dots, you know, already OpenAlt community, companies, Red Hat, etc., the public administration offices like DIA, etc., put together and basically discuss it. And we as Open Cities are already planning the project, as I told also in the previous presentation. So we are already planning the project for kickstart this event to have at least some sort of money to really get things done in Czech. So thank you, passing back to Jacob.
Thank you, Jiri, thank you, Dorka. I have another question for you. How do we define success? And if we look, if we project forward 5 years from now, and we're looking at some of, if we were to write some headlines of what we've accomplished so far, what would you like to see those headlines to be, or how do you find success? Maybe you can give us a little insights into that, either one.
I'll start because it's going to be short, because I'm really bad at aspirational statements. That's something that I cannot do. But I feel like it's important to highlight that we're doing this in Brno, because it's not a coincidence that Red Hat Czech has the second largest office, or I think now third largest office here in Brno. It's like a great environment, great ecosystem to build stuff, to innovate. And especially for us, I guess. Which brings me to how do I define success? So I would focus maybe as a Red Hatter a little bit now on a talent pool. That's growing, but it can always be more. And I'd also say something like Red Hat was there to lay grounds for the Czech National OSPO. And I'll leave it up to Jirka because, as I said, I'm very bad at aspirational stuff.
Yeah, it's definitely, if we are basically established that Brno is the open innovation hub for the Czech Republic, you know, this is definitely what the label could do. That's one thing, what Dorka said, and for the talent attraction is definitely the thing. Thank you. And second thing, for example, on the practical point of view, if we are able, for example, in 5 years, said, hey, Paris has its open source software, and as we have heard, they have it for themselves, but they are not like have a strong community. Yeah. So basically, if we are able to have a real use of some part of the Paris software, you know, also in Czech Republic, and maybe vice versa, yeah, in Paris. So this would be really nice in 5 years, you know, if you count the public administration speed, basically, of digitalization, etc. It is not a pejorative thing, it's just the fact, you know, that the public administration works differently than industry, for example, or NGO. So basically, yeah, for me, if I would make these KPI, like an indicator. So if we are able to do a successful collaboration with open source city Paris, with open cities or any city here, for example, Baltimore, and yeah, and with the new member Prague and also in Brno. So it would be really great. And I pass Dorka, do you want to say anything more?
Oh, I just wanted to add, yet again, it's not very, very like fully formed, but I'd like a Czech national OSPO to maybe focus a little bit, like not just on consumers, but on contributors, and see that number to get higher and higher. That would be a definition of success for me.
One more question that's not so rosy. So we talked about what you see as some of the aspirational aspects. What about some of the challenges and barriers that we're going to face building OSPOs? Yeah.
So as was mentioned, digitalization of public administration and also of academia, you know, it's a topic by itself, you know, and we are adding the complexity of open source there, you know. So to start thinking in the way everything that is done in open, it's not to be open, but to be reused, you know. And so this kind of, I would say, management change, you know, this is one of the barriers that we are going to face it. For example, in open content with Lucy here, so we labeled that thing like reuse system management, you know, because basically circular economy in digital environment, you know, somehow that. So it's definitely a topic. It's going to be more and more complex topic in coming years. And this is really one of the barriers because usually we are not prepared and think about yourself, how you are doing the work, you know. We are not prepared to think on reuse when we start drafting, I don't know, a document or some project, you know, from the first time. Not many people are doing that, you know, and this is going to change because now in the information age, when we have plenty of information, so basically we will need to think in this way. So this is one barrier. And the second thing is definitely the basic things that open source, it's not secure, you know, it's not stable, you need these SLAs and you need the companies that will provide basically the insurance for that. Yeah, this will be there, you know, but I think that if we are able to encourage academia and public sector, you know, to put it, for example, the open source code in the CodeGov CZ, so this will be really good.
Oh, okay. I'll talk yet again about contribution more and how to engage with developers locally. So my experience, I guess, from talking to developers is that you can sort of do it in two ways. So one of them is like very technology focused, technology driven. So you know what you do and you want to talk about what you do. And there are these other maybe ways to do it, and OpenAlt is definitely one of them, like to get together a broad group of people with like similar interests, similar experience, similar knowledge, and talk about what's currently happening. And I feel like that's very challenging. So that might be not a barrier, but like a challenging part of what we want to do here.
Yeah. Would you follow up on that real quick?
Okay.
Would you then help to say, if that's one of the challenges, would you help to say that that's, if we were going to define success, you're looking for more bringing together different groups is part of success.
Yes, yeah. Oh yeah, we're back to a previous question, basically. Yes, you're right, that's a part of success.
And I wanted to say only, there's you on one of your slides, it was about digital diplomacy, you know, and basically for our endeavor in Czech national, and I am OSPO, and I would feel also worldwide will be the kind of looking for the languages between these public officers and academia officers with developers, you know, I'm finding the bridges, you know, between that. This will be a task. It is not visible. It will be not KPI'd because it will be really a lot of like undergoing work that is not seen, but without that, it's not possible to make the change, you know. So I would say that this is a huge barrier, but with these approaches and common, I would say common
language,
we can overcome it.
I think that's it. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Jacob.
Thank you all.
Yes, sorry. So again, so the question was, the question was how the citizens and active people in the Czech Republic can help building Czech OSPO. So basically, we are going to do a Brno open source declaration. It will be on our website. There will be a button. You can sign it if you agree with that. And we will contact you, you know, with further information. And there will be, if you are like you alone or you are talking from some institution or organization. Thank you for the question. And Dorka wants to add something.
So I'm not sure if this is correct, but also for the Otevřené města or yes. Open cities, you can contribute, people can contribute to your projects, right?
Yes.
So that's like a direct way to do it right now?
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. You can, yeah.
And UNESCO Digital, yes.
Yeah. Yes. So basically, you can, if you are a programmer, so you can contact Open Cities directly. We have Open GitHub, so, and GitLab also, so you can help us. Thank you, Dorka. Any other question? So if not, we are closing this session and we go for lunch. And I would like to thank you very much, James, once again, to coming here and be with us. And I'm looking forward to the cooperation. Thank you very much.
Similarly, thank you.
Thank you.